to destroy the works of the evil one, and the kingdom of darkness with light, and to rescue men from the law of sin. This is the gospel of Christ, to proclaim good news unto the poor.
The gospel of Christ, spreading the soul-saving message of Jesus. And now, Ben Bailey.
This is the gospel of Christ.
God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. John chapter 3 and verse 16. Welcome to our study of the eternal love of God. What is it that will motivate, that will encourage people to want to be saved, to want to go to heaven? One of the greatest factors is the wonderful love that God has for mankind. Think about it. God so loved man that He gave His only Son so that we could go to heaven. Look at the sacrifice and look at the love that God showed and has shown for mankind. There are a host of passages in the Scripture that teach us about God's wonderful love. Paul speaks about this in Romans chapter 5, beginning in verses 6 through 8. He says, "While we were still without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man one die, yet perhaps for a good man someone might even dare to die. But God demonstrates His own love toward us." Listen. "In that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." And when man was at his worst, God sent the antidote to sin. He gave His Son so that we could have the hope of heaven. John was thinking about this idea of God's wonderful love when he said in 1 John 3 verse 1, "Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we can be called children of God, and this we are." What a privilege and blessing it is to be a child of God, and that has happened because of the love of God. You know, the love of God is not just a wonderful idea, not just a beautiful picture in Scripture. It is a motivating factor for obedience to the gospel and faithfulness to Jesus Christ. Paul mentions this in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. He says this, "The love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that they who live should no longer live for themselves, but live for Him who died for them and rose again." If Christ died for me, that ought to motivate and compel me to want to do the will of God. One of the most illustrative passages of the love of God is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 9. I want you to notice the beautiful picture from heaven's standpoint of God's love. Notice 2 Corinthians 8 and verse 9. The Scripture says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, yet for your sakes He became poor, that you through His poverty might become rich." Think about all that Jesus had. He's in the very place we want to go. He left heaven, came to this earth, didn't have a place to call His own, lived as a man, was ridiculed by His own creation, hung on a cruel cross, and died. Why? Because He loved me so much that He wanted me to go to heaven. Truly, nothing can separate us from the love of God. It is one of the most powerful factors in salvation. Romans chapter 8, verses 37 through 39. But with the idea of God's love is His eternal nature. God Himself has existed forever, and that's even a hard idea to explain. God has always been, Psalm 90 verses 1 through 2, from everlasting to everlasting, You are God. Jesus prayed in John 17, 3, "Restore to me that which we had from eternity." He is the eternal King. Deuteronomy 33 verse 27, He is the eternal God. Psalm 93 verse 2, Isaiah 57 verse 15, He inhabits eternity, as Jeremiah 10 verse 10 and Isaiah 57 teaches us. And so here we have the wonderful love of God. this beautiful picture that God Himself is eternal, and both of these ideas combine very uniquely to show us God's eternal plan. His eternal love and His eternal plan to save mankind. God's eternal nature and His love are uniquely tied together in His eternal plan to save mankind. 2 Timothy 1 verse 9 says that God had been working from before time began, from eternity, had been planning a way to save mankind. 1 Peter 1 verses 18 through 20 says that we're not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from our aimless conduct handed down by tradition from our fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ. As a lamb without spot or blemish, listen, He was foreordained before the foundations of the world, but was manifest in these last times or days for us. Think about it. God, before He ever created man, before He ever created the world, had already planned a way to save us. And thus, we're living in hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before time began. Titus chapter 1 and verse 2. And so as we think about God's love, I know at times we understand and we believe in the love of God. Do we really appreciate and take comfort in that love? Or sometimes do we just view God as a fearful and vindictive God who's just waiting for us to mess up so He can punish us? Let's realize that God is a loving God. He's the epitome of love. And yes, God will punish those who don't do His will, but we need to see God as a God of love also. And so how can we see God's love? We're going to do two very important things in this lesson. First of all, we're going to notice how God's love is demonstrated. How can I see? How can I come to appreciate the love of God? And secondly, we're going to ask, what does the love of God demand of me? How's it demonstrated? Where can I see it at? But just as importantly, I want to know, in view of that great love, what does it require of me? What does God ask of me to really show my love for Him also? And so let's notice, first of all, how the love of God is demonstrated. How is God's love demonstrated toward each and every one of us today? How can we know that God loves us? God's love is clearly illustrated in the sacrificial death of His Son for our sins. I know God loves me because He sent His own Son to this world to hang in agony on a cruel cross and die as a sacrifice for my sins. As you see Jesus on the cross, see the picture of God's great love. The Bible says in 1 Peter 2 verse 24 that we're healed by His stripes. The stripes of Jesus is what heals man from sin. We see Jesus on the tree, and there He is, and He hung in agony for my sins and for yours so that we could have the hope of heaven. Listen to the beautiful words that Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 5 verse 21 about the sacrifice and the love of God. The Bible says, He, God, made Him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. God made Christ, who didn't have sin in His life. He was tempted in all points as we are, yet without sin. What did God make Him to be? To be a sin offering for us so that we could escape the penalty of sin. John the Immerser sees Jesus approaching, and here's what he says, recorded in John 1 verse 29. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Isaiah writes about this years before it happens and says, He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon Him, and by His stripes we are healed. Isaiah 53 and verse 4. I want you to think for just a moment about the events that happened on Golgotha, the events leading up to the crucifixion of Jesus. Stop and think about just for a minute how much God loves you and how much He loves me and how that's illustrated in the sacrifice of Jesus. Jesus had committed no sin, and yet evil men bound the hands of Jesus. Mark 15, 1. They carried Him away as a common criminal. They mocked Him. They laughed at Him. They spit in the face of the Savior. They took their hands and they beat Jesus. They then placed a a crown of thorns. And we're not talking about little briars here. We're talking about the long needle-like thorns. They placed that crown of thorns on his head. And then the scripture records that they beat him on the head with a rod, piercing his brow with that thorn, with those thorns. And then Jesus was beaten with a whip, something like a cat of nine tails, over and over again on his back. Can you imagine the bloody back of Jesus, the crown-pierced brow? Think about the thorn-pierced brow. And then they take a robe and they place that over the back of Jesus. And Scripture tells us they didn't take that off. Can you imagine as the robe dried to his back and to the blood, and then they take it off and it starts all over again? They take him up the hill to Golgotha. They there nail his hands and his feet to the cross, and Jesus hangs in agony until he draws his last breath. Why did Jesus do that? Why'd God allow that? That is a picture, the clearest picture you can have of God's love. Hebrews 2 verse 9, Jesus tasted death for every man. And so when I think about how is God's love demonstrated, I think about what Jesus suffered, what God allowed His Son to suffer. But there's another way we can know God loves us. God's love is also exemplified in the forgiveness of sins. The very fact that God is willing to forgive us our sins is a clear picture, a clear indication of God's love. In Matthew chapter 27 and verse 46, Jesus cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Do you know what the answer to that question is? I'm the answer, and you're the answer to that question. You see, Isaiah 59, 1 and 2 teaches us that sin separates a man from God. God is of pure eyes than to behold evil, and He cannot look upon wickedness. Habakkuk chapter 1 and verse 13, and yet God made Christ, who knew no sin, to be sin on our behalf. God allowed His own Son to be the sin sacrifice, and momentarily our sins were placed on Him. 1 Peter 2 and verse 24. And so when I think about God's love, think about it in the forgiveness that God offers through His Son. One of the most beautiful passages showing us God's forgiveness is found in Psalm 103, verses 10 through 12. I want you to notice what the Scripture says here. Look at these words. The Bible says, God has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is His mercy toward those who fear Him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us. Think about those words. He, God, has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. When I obey the gospel, and because of the sacrifice of Jesus, do we understand what's being said there? I don't get what I deserve for sin. The psalmist also said it very beautifully in Psalm 130, verses 4 through 5. If you, O Lord, were to mark iniquities, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you that you may be feared. Think about it. If God kept a marker and a mark every time I sinned, and every time I sinned, He made a mark on the board, at the end, who would be able to stand? Well, no one would. Thus, there is forgiveness with God. Hebrews 8 and verses 12 and 13 teaches us the forgiveness of God. I'll be merciful to their sins and their lawless deeds. I'll remember no more. Micah 7 verse 18 teaches us about God's forgiveness. He said, I'll cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. And didn't Jesus beautifully say it as He taught about the Lord's Supper in Matthew 26 verse 28? He took that fruit of the vine and He said, this is My blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission or forgiveness of sins. And so I can know God loves me because He sacrificed His own Son, because He's willing to forgive me of sin. But I can also see God's love by the picture of God, by the Word of God found in our Bible today. God shows His love toward us by giving us the Bible. Think about it. We have the revealed, perfect, and complete Word of God. All Scripture is inspired of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped unto every good work. This is a book that is not of human origin, but holy men of God spoke as they were guided or moved by the Holy Spirit. This book is all truth. John 17, verse 17, sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth, and that truth is what sets us free from sin. Remember John 8, 32? Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free, and every word of God is pure and true. Psalm 119, verse 160, Psalm 19, verses 6 through 8. But you know, here's how all this ties together. I understand this is the Word of God. I'm thankful for God's revelation, but how does that illustrate His love? It's by the gospel, by this book, by the words found in it, that we're saved. Romans 1:16 says the gospel is God's power unto salvation. James thought about the wonderful idea of God's saving power found in the gospel, and he wrote these words in James 1, verse 21. The scripture records, therefore lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. How are we going to find salvation? It's the Word of God. 1 Peter 1, verses 23 through 25. We're born again by the Word of God. It's that Word revealed in the Bible that makes salvation available. And so I know God loves me because He gave me the Bible, the message of salvation. I can also see God's love by His providing for and taking care of our physical and spiritual needs. You know what's great about being a Christian? I know and I'm convinced that God will take care of all of our needs. Every good and perfect gift comes down from above, from the Father of lights, with whom there is no shadow or variation of turning, James said in James 1, verse 17. Jesus taught about God providing for our needs in Matthew 6, verse 24, and He taught about the birds of the air, the lilies of the field, even Solomon in all his glory, and He said, you're of more value than they. We are the pinnacle of God's creation, and God will take care of us. Paul realized this in his own life, and he stated it very clearly in Philippians 4, verse 19. My God shall supply all your needs, not every want we have, but all our needs in Christ Jesus. I want you to notice one of the most beautiful statements about God taking care of and providing for His own. It's found in Psalm 37 and verse 25. Look at these beautiful words. The scripture says, David speaking, I've been young and now I'm old, yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his descendants begging bread. David kind of takes a picture of life, and he says, here's one thing I've seen. I'm old, but I've been young, and I've seen these things. Righteous people don't starve. Righteous people don't go hungry. God takes care of His own. So I know God loves me because He promises and He fulfills those promises to always take care of His own. I know God loves me because of what He's promised us after this life. God's love is showered upon us in the beautiful promises we have of heaven. Jesus said, the righteous will go away into eternal life. Matthew 25, verse 46. When Jesus taught His disciples to pray, He said, pray, our Father who art in heaven. That's what makes heaven wonderful, the fact that God is there, that we can be there with God. Remember what Jesus said about His going to the Father in John 14? Jesus said, I'm going to the Father. And they said, Lord, we don't know where You're going. We don't know the way. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by Me. Don't you want to go to heaven? Think about the beauty and the splendor of that place. Think about the way the Hebrews writer put it in Hebrews 4, verse 9. Look at these beautiful words. The scripture says, there remains therefore a rest for the people of God. Don't you want to go to that wonderful place of rest? That place described in Revelation 21, verses 3 and 4, as a place where there'll be no more death, no more sorrow, no more sin. All the former things have passed away. And so can we see God's love demonstrated for us? Absolutely. But the love of God also demands things of us. God's love is a free gift. It is the most beautiful and motivating factor in Scripture. But if I'm going to view the love of God correctly, I've also got to see what it is that the love of God demands of me. First of all, the love of God demands that I obey God's will. You cannot say, God, I love you, and then live any way that you want to do. The first and greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Mark chapter 12, verse 30 following. Jesus taught that we can't just say, Lord, Lord. Not everybody who says, Lord, Lord, is going to heaven, but he who does the will of the Father. Matthew 7, verse 21. Jesus asked a haunting question of those who thought they were the religious elite. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things which I say? But then I want you to see how these ideas are uniquely tied together. John 14, verse 15 teaches us this principle. Jesus said this very simply, if you love me, keep my commandments. Companion passage, John 15, verse 14, Jesus said, you are my friends if you do whatever I command you. Are there any conditions to the love of God? Is the love of God just a free gift and just a feeling that we get? No, God's love says, if you love me, you must keep my commandments. Behold, to obey is better than to sacrifice. 1 Samuel 15, verse 21 following. And so, first of all, the love of God demands that I obey God's will. The love of God also demands that I live a faithful Christian life. I can't say, well, I love God and God loves me and I'm going to go live however I want to. It's not how it works. The Scripture teaches because of the love of God, we live faithfully to Jesus Christ. Paul thought about his life now in view of the love of God, and here's what he said. I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. Paul said, my life's no longer about me. Because of God's love, I too have been crucified. It is the love of Christ that compels us, because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And He died for all, that they who live should no longer live for themselves, but live for Him who died for them and rose again. I must also die to sin and live faithfully to Jesus Christ. Paul illustrates how that our life as a faithful Christian in view of the love of God must now be a sacrifice. Notice Romans chapter 12 and verse 1. The Scripture says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. How is my life to be viewed now? I am a living sacrifice. I am to serve God acceptably. I am to live a transformed life. Jesus spoke to Christians who were suffering in the first century, and He said this, be faithful until death, and I'll give you the crown of life. Revelation 2, verse 10. Jesus taught that our view of life must now be, seek first the kingdom of God. Matthew 6, verse 33. Paul illustrated his own view of life when he said in Philippians 1, 21, for to me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. And Jesus demands of each of us that we deny ourselves, take up our cross daily, and follow Him. Living a faithful Christian life is what God demands in view of His love for each one of us. The love of God in Scripture also demands that I love those who are inside the family of God. As we think about loving one another, the Bible says in Hebrews 13, verse 1, let brotherly love continue. Not like the people in Luke chapter 10, verse 30, who the priest and the religious elite who pass by the man who's hurt, but like the good Samaritan who is willing to stop and help that man in need and do what he could for him. Jesus taught us this in John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. Notice the words of Christ. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. As I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. The love of God demands that I love others inside the family of God. Think about it. How can a person say, I love God, but I don't like the family of God? I love God, but I don't love my brothers and sisters. If you don't love the Father, if you don't love the family, you really don't love the Father either. And so we must love God's children. But the love of God also demands that I love the lost enough to try to save their soul. I can't say I love God and not have the concern that I ought to for others who are lost in sin. Luke 19:10, Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. Jesus taught us our mission was to go into all the world and spread the gospel unto every creature. Mark 16, verse 15. Jesus taught us, as illustrated through Paul's words and Paul taught, that we're to warn every man, teach every man, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 28. And so today, we ask you, do you really understand? Have you seen the love of God? God loved us so much, He sacrificed His Son for us. He gave us the Bible. He's willing to forgive our sins. He promises to always take care of His own. And we've got the wonderful hope of heaven. If you see God's love, then the next question is, have you responded properly to the love of God? The love of God demands that I obey Him. Remember, it was Jesus who said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Do you really love the Lord? Do you love God? If so, have you obeyed the gospel as Jesus taught? Jesus taught that to become a Christian, you must hear the Word of God. Romans 10, verse 17, you must be willing to believe in Him as God's Son. The Scriptures teach in John 8:24 that if you don't believe in Jesus, you can't be saved. Once you believe in Jesus, you must be willing to repent of your sin. Luke chapter 13, verse 3, and you must confess the name of Jesus before men. Matthew 10, verse 32 and 33. And having done those things, you also must be baptized in water to be saved. It was Jesus who said, he who believes and is baptized will be saved. If you've seen God's love, then ask yourself, have I really obeyed the gospel? Am I living faithful unto death? Friend, our prayer for you is that you will love God enough to obey the gospel and be faithful all the days of your life. May God help each of us to love Him as He has loved us. You may have just joined our program and are wondering, what is the gospel of Christ? The gospel of Christ is an evangelistic work of the churches of Christ that reaches the whole world with the gospel through TV, radio, and internet. Our motto is to take the whole gospel to the whole world. We believe in having a book, chapter, and verse for everything we say and do. And unlike many religious groups today, we're concerned about lost souls, not your wallet.
We encourage you to visit thegospelofchrist.com for a host of Bible study materials as well as audio and video copies of our lessons. If you would like to have a copy of today's lesson, please visit our website and fill out a media request form, or you can email us at mail@thegospelofchrist.com. Call us toll-free at 1-855-458-3905 or write to us at P.O. Box 788, McMinnville, Tennessee, 37111.